Sarah read and was incredibly nervous, it looked like, and apologized while she was reading. Thought that was awesome.
Amen.
Colossians chapter 3 is where we're going to find our main verse this morning that's going to help us to move forward. So 2023 at the light is the year of freedom. That's our word for this year. And we are working on finding freedom from all different kinds of things in our life. We've talked about different things so far. We've talked about how do we find freedom from religion. That was fun. How do we find freedom from shame? We talked about how do we have the freedom to fear God. And then last week we talked about freedom from pride. And that was no fun whatsoever. The word today that we're going to talk about is freedom from chaos. Freedom from chaos. Raise your hand if your life is in chaos right now. Anybody feel that way in their life? I got double hands going up in the back. That's good. Freedom from chaos. That's, man, if you're not in chaos right now, seeing potential UFO sightings on Fox News everywhere, I don't know. I mean, it just feels like Independence Day is going down right now. So I'm just playing, man. It is a crazy world that we live in. No doubt. And the situations are different for different people, but chaos is very real. And you can't change the circumstances of the world that you live in necessarily, but you can control the way that you navigate through the waters of chaos in your life. Amen?
Amen.
We can do that. So it's kind of this idea, how do you react during chaos? This is the question that I want to start out with. How do you react during chaos? Because I think that when you go through chaos, it gives you a really good idea of what you value in your life. Let me just show it to you like this. How many of y'all hate to fly? Y'all hate to fly. Okay, a lot of people, not as many as I thought. So I don't mind flying, but I don't like turbulence. Turbulence is not really just a whole lot of fun. But if we were on a plane together, Jose, you and I, we're flying, and we're on a plane together, and all of a sudden both of the engines go out. If there's two, let's just call it, say that there's two. All of the engines go out at that moment. Okay, and so what's going to happen is it's going to be a time of chaos. It's going to be crazy. I'm going to be able to see what's important to you during that time. Because, so what's the words that are going to come out of your mouth? And I'm going to give you a few that aren't appropriate. I'm just going to go ahead and say, I'm preaching to a bunch of sinners here. I know y'all are going to say some words that you probably shouldn't say. But after those words come out, like, what do you say? Are you praying?
Yes.
Like, is that what's important to you? Like, times of chaos really bring that out. It's that refiner's fire, you know? Like, when you put those precious metals in the furnace and it brings out the impurities, I think that's what chaos does for us. It just really shows us, hey, whenever the heat is on, whenever the chaos begins to kick in our life, these are the things that are important to me. These are the things that that I value. So the question today that I really want us to understand is how do we make it through difficult days in different ways than the people that we're around? Like, how do we become a people who, when people see us going through times of chaos, that they look at us and they begin, they drop their animosity and it brings curiosity. Like, why are they living a life like this? And so that's what we're going to talk about. Freedom from chaos. Everybody say chaos.
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 Everybody
chaos.
Say chaos a little bit louder.
Chaos.
Okay. All right. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 and 2. Let me just read it one more time. Since you have been raised to new life with Christ, that is you, if you have accepted the forgiveness that comes from Jesus Christ by the repentance of your sin. The blood of Jesus has washed your sins away. If you've been raised to new life with Christ, that's you. Okay? Set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Verse 2. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. Okay, so I've kind of broken down our navigation plan. I'm not a 3 points preacher, but we have 3 points today that are going to help us to work through times of chaos. Okay, 3 different words. We're going to learn how to guard our words. We're going to learn how to guard our thoughts. And we're going to learn how to guard our time. Okay, these 3 things are incredibly important when you're going through times of chaos. Okay, so let's say this. Words,
words.
Thoughts,
thoughts,
time. Okay, point 1, guard your time. We're going to do this quick because we're talking about time. We can't take a lot of time on it, okay? Point number one, guard your time. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 16, it says, make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Guard your time. In times of chaos, you have to learn how to guard your time. The Bible says, make the best of every opportunity. Like when things are going crazy, make the most of every opportunity. In times of chaos, we have to learn how to guard our time and make the most of every single opportunity. I just thought of this. I saw Jack walk in from the back. I know there's a lot of stories that revolve around this. But whenever the tornado hit, that was a time of chaos, correct? And so, Jack, I kind of thought about this just now. It's like Ephesians 5:16, make the most of every opportunity. Like in times of chaos, Jack's thought was, how many brisket tacos can I get out to the whole community? Like that's how can I make a difference in the world? Amen. Those were some good. I helped cook them and I ate probably more than we handed out. It was so good. So how do I make the most of every opportunity? That's guarding my time. James chapter 4 verse 14. Yet you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow. How many of y'all know what your life's going to be like tomorrow? None of us, okay? So you don't know what your life's going to be like tomorrow, for you are just a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. Is your life worth living a chaotic life if you don't even know what it's going to be like tomorrow? Why are we so stressed out and worried about tomorrow when we don't even know what's going to come from? We have to learn how to guard our time, because times of chaos create opportunities for the priorities in our life to become skewed. Justin's reading a book that I don't know what it is. He sent me a picture though. What's that book called? Beyond Blessed. Okay, I've read that book. That's a good one. I can pull it out just from a little picture, but it said this: not everything that seems urgent is truly important, and not everything that's genuinely important is urgent. Okay, it takes me like 3 times to read stuff to actually understand things. I'm gonna read that one more time. Not everything that seems urgent is truly important, and not everything that is genuinely important. It's urgent. I'm an illustration guy, so I'm going to have to show you like this. We got home last night from Eden. We had some cottons. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So good. Had the border special. So good. In Jesus' name. So we ate some cottons. We got back. And typically what our Saturday nights look like at my house is that Brittany is going to spend the night watching movies about sharks. And then I go out to my office and I read over my sermon notes. I read the Bible and I pray. I just kind of try to spend a couple hours out there. So that way I can maintain my 2-star rating with y'all, okay? So I'll go out there, and we got home from eating, and it was a little later than normal, and Cora asked me, she said, Dad, do you want to go play Mario Kart with me on the Switch? And I was really, really tempted to tell her, hey, I gotta study my sermon. Like, it's really important. I'm preaching it tomorrow, and so how about tomorrow after church? How about we play? And I'll play like 3 or 4 rounds with you. We'll play a long time. That was my initial thought. But then, and this is the urgency and importance idea, I'm so thankful that it clicked in my mind. And I was like, no, this is way more important. Mario Kart with my daughter is way more important than it could be to go out into my office and study. And so that's how we kind of get this idea mixed up of what's truly important and what's urgent. You see, because urgent really wasn't that important. It was just something that I wanted to do. It's the same way when you're, dads, you're sending an email and your kid comes up to you and they say, Dad, you want to throw the football with me? And you go, yeah, let me finish this email. The email seems really urgent, but it's not what's actually important. You just told your child, you just said, hey, this email is actually more important than you. It's moms. It's the same thing when you're sending a text to a friend and your daughter's standing there and she's going, Mom, and it takes you forever, and you go, hold on, just let me finish this text message real quick. That's us, like, misunderstanding the idea of what's urgent and what's truly important, because times of chaos will make this be skewed in our life. We forget, we need to, in times of chaos, I check boxes. I need to check things off of my list, that way I can move on to the next task and try to take some of the chaos out of my life. Jesus, I thought about Jesus. That's a good thing to do when you're preaching a sermon. Think about Jesus, right? Amen. Just think about Jesus. And I was like, how did Jesus respond? And I thought, Jesus got baptized, and then he took a 40-day vacation. I mean, it wasn't really a vacation. It was pretty awful, I think. But Jesus gets baptized, has this amazing moment, and then he retreats for 40 days in prayer and fasting and in temptation. And Jesus, it's this idea that, man, what's truly urgent, Jesus came to share the kingdom of heaven with all of us here on earth. That was actually what was really, really urgent, but what was important to him was actually to spend time with the Father. And he needed to build up and to build his faith and to go out to the wilderness and to spend time in prayer. So don't mix up what's urgent and what's actually important. So you have to learn how to guard your time when things are chaotic. So the questions that we have are what's the non-negotiable things in your life when things are chaotic? What's the things that you refuse to give up? A lot of people give up the things that are actually important for the sake of urgency. Things are chaotic. I urgently need to take care of these things. What are you not willing to give up? Church is probably one of the first things that people will give up because things are chaotic. Things are out of control, and I just didn't get enough rest this week. I haven't had any time with just my family or whatever. Man, people will give up their quiet time faster than anything. I need 15 more minutes of sleep. We give up the things that are actually important for the sake of urgency. So number one is guard your time. Y'all liking this yet? It's good?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Awesome. Point number two, guard your words. Oh man, this is going to be good. How do people of Christ navigate chaos? Okay, we don't sit around and soak in the chaos, right? We set our mind on his authority. This is what the Bible says. Since you've been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven. This is what we do. The other word, translations will say seek. Seek and set your mind on. The word seek, it's an orientation of will. This is what it means. It means that I always obtain the power to decide what I pursue. Seeking means that no matter the situation, no matter how chaotic that it is, that I always reserve the power for what I'm going to pursue in my life. That means that no matter how chaotic that things are at the Light Church, we'll just go from this area right here. No matter how chaotic that things are, we seek the purpose of what we're going to pursue. We obtain the right to pursue that we're going to reach, revive, and unite like eternity depends on it. That's what our purpose is here at the Light. This is seeking the things of God. We obtain the power to decide what we're going to pursue on. How many of y'all have ever been the subject of a rumor in town? Any town. This one, another town. Okay. Not everybody? Man, y'all haven't been living right if y'all haven't been the subject of a rumor in town. Words are hurtful. Brittany and I, we have a rule at our house. We talk about no drama in our house. I'll talk about drama in my car. I'll talk about drama at the restaurant. But I don't talk about drama in my house. I am so tired of drama. This is like a pretty new thing, actually. We'll see how long it lasts. If you're in our house, the only thing you get to talk about is how amazing that the door is that I made with my bare hands. Right? If you were here last week, you know about that. That's all we get to talk about in our house. But man, your words are really powerful. If you want freedom from chaos and if you want freedom from drama, stop entertaining it. You have the power to stop entertaining drama in your life. You can literally say no. Like, and the other thing is this, is that you don't have to have the last word either. I'm just going to scan for dramatic effects. You don't have to have the last word. You really don't. Your words are powerful. The Bible says this in Proverbs 17, verse 28. It says, even fools are thought wise when they keep silent. With their mouths shut, they seem intelligent. You can be a fool and people are going to think that you're an intelligent person if you just keep your mouth shut. Some of our teenagers, y'all need to learn this because, Jose, we wish we would have learned this when we were younger. Keep your mouth shut and you will seem intelligent. You will keep yourself out of trouble if you do this. Silence can be wise, man. Don't waste your words creating more chaos. We speak 5,000 to 20,000 words a day. I think I triple that. I'm pretty sure I'm like in 60,000 range. I talk a lot of words. Some of y'all talk probably less than 5,000 words. But they say you're going to speak about 5,000 to 20,000 words a day. And I was thinking about this, and I thought, how many words do I say in a week and that I don't even know what I said? I just said words. Like, your words are really, they're important. Like, and the question that I was thinking to myself is, did I use my words wisely? Like, how did I actually use my words? Were my words wasted on creating more chaos in my life? What were my words, or who were my words about this week? What situations were my words about? Were they bringing peace to people, or were they creating more chaos in my life? Here's a little Valentine's Day plug. Fellas, Valentine's Day is this week. I know it's on a Tuesday and that snuck up to you, so just, you know. But I've learned this in marriage. You don't have to say what's on your mind. Silence can be very valuable. I did this week. I came home from men's prayer group on Monday night. Tab was talking about how amazing this red velvet something that Miss Janet made and how amazing that it was. And he was bragging on his wife. And I went home and I told Brittany, I just wish I had something red velvet like Miss Janet made because it was amazing. And she was like, well, why don't you go live with Miss Janet and Mr. Tab? We don't have to say the words that are on our mind. Your words should be led by the Spirit, not by your feelings. Don't let your words be led by your feelings. When they're led by your feelings, they're going to bring death. I don't know how many of you guys have had moments in your life where you can remember how words, how they were hurtful to you. I can remember going into places and seeing and hearing people that I love and still do, but I can remember walking into rooms with them talking about me and how hurtful that, like, I still remember that. Like, man, I thought you loved me and you're going to say those words about me. I heard a rumor this week about myself and I was like, that's not true. It literally brought me to tears. I was like, man, that's not true at all. Our words can be incredibly hurtful. So here's what I was thinking was that if I know that our words can be hurtful, then why don't I guard my words more? Like, if I know that other words can hurt me, then why don't I protect the words that come out of my mouth so I don't hurt other people? My words have a tendency to create more chaos because I just need to speak what's on my mind, and that's not what we need to do. The Bible says in Proverbs 18, verse 8, it says, rumors are dainty morsels that sink deep into one's heart. Have y'all ever gossiped about somebody? I'm just going to go ahead and say something. Like, gossiping, like, to a degree, actually feels really good. Just because it's good doesn't, or it feels good doesn't mean it is good, okay? But it's kind of nice to, like, have a little bit of information that other people don't know about, right? You go, hey, did you see a friend or a group of people, and you're like, you know something that you want to say, and you find a way to cleverly kind of sneak it into a conversation and say, hey, yeah, did you hear about this or did you hear about that? That's what the Bible's saying. Hey, man, it's like a dainty morsel that sinks, but it sinks deep into somebody's heart. Okay, and so we release it and it feels good, but it brings death, and our words can actually separate friends. Our words can separate relationships with other people. We have to guard our words, because if we don't guard our words, then we're creating more chaos in the world that we live in. You've got to guard your words. Proverbs 12, verse 18, it says, some people make cutting remarks, but the words of the wise, they bring healing. I can still remember words that were spoken to me 20 years ago that when they feel like, you know, it says that it's a cutting remark. It's the same idea of a sword or a knife going in and twisting. It hurt. Our words hurt. You have to be parents. I teed this one up on purpose, but you have to be very careful with the words that you say to your children. They will remember. Every one of us in this room can probably remember words that were spoken about us when we were kids. The words, while your child is on the field or on a court, that you say, they matter way more. The words that you say while they're playing and when they get off the court, they matter way more than the performance of your child. Because in 20 years, your child's still going to remember that, and you're not going to remember how they played. Guard your words. This is fun? Let's keep going. This is going to be great. Freedom. If I would have known, we would have never went with this theme for the year. Freedom. So words create chaos. Silence is valuable. Let's remember that. But your words come from your mind. So more than anything, let's learn how we guard our mind. Okay. Point number three, guard your thoughts. The Bible says that we set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. If you want freedom from chaos, think, guard your thoughts about the things of heaven, not the things of earth.
Amen.
You have to set your mind, determine your mind. Determining in your mind where you're headed will determine your steps. Brittany and I were on vacation last summer, headed to Florida. We were driving down the interstate, having a great time. We had already stopped at Bucky's and Terrell. It was just a really phenomenal morning. We were cruising down the road. It's like 11:30. And Brittany was like, she knows that that's when Big Daddy gets hangry. And she was like, hey, do you want to stop and grab some lunch? And I was like, you know, I just had some Beaver Nuggets. Well, let's just kind of keep on moving. But let's find a place to pull in and let's get some food. And so we're cruising down the road. And I remember we were driving and it was like, oh, there's a Chick-fil-A. Oh, that would have been good. But we passed the exit, didn't we? We sure did. And we're driving even further. And it was like, oh, there's Raising Cane's. I love Raising Cane's. How many of y'all love Raising Cane's? That dipping sauce is so good. And the toast, so good. Thank you, Jesus. Cruising down the road, some Cane's. And get a little further and we passed the Texas Roadhouse. And over and over and over again, we just kept passing these amazing restaurants. And by this time, I am getting frustrated. I am definitely hangry by this point. And I realize it's 1 o'clock. We've been driving for an hour and a half looking for a place to eat. And we were still in the same place that we were before, just 90 miles further down the road. If you don't actually know the direction that you're headed, if you don't set your thoughts on where you want to be, you're going to go, like, you're not going to get anywhere. And the Bible says, hey, set your thoughts on the things above. Set your thoughts on the things of heaven, because where you set your thoughts are, that's the place where you're going to be headed. If your thoughts are on things of earth and the things that we see here on earth and only earthly things, you are not going to live to the fullest potential that God has created for you to live. So we have to learn how to set our mind on the things of heaven. This is how we get into messes with a lot of our things that we go through, is we haven't ever set our mind on the things and places that we want to head to. It's when we get in, our finances, we can get in a lot of trouble with them because things are good and things are fine and we just kind of live just kind of how we want to. And then all of a sudden times of chaos hit, and then all of a sudden we get it like in this panic mode because we never prepared. We never thought about, hey, if this happens, what am I going to do? The Bible says in Proverbs 21 verse 20, it says the wise have wealth and luxury, but fools spend whatever they get. It means that you haven't set your mind on the things of heaven with how you're going to steward your finances. This is how marriages struggle. Like, chaos hits and you don't communicate. You don't know where you're going to be headed. And all of a sudden, man, what was a little bit of chaos because you haven't set your mind on where you wanted to be as a marriage, now it's just completely blown up. So let me give you a statement right here that we have to make a conscious, willful decision to direct our thoughts to Jesus. And here's why. Okay? Ready for this? What I think about determines what I care about, and what I care about determines what I chase in my life. Let's do that again. What I think about determines what I care about, and what I care about determines what I pursue in my life. So, what are you allowing to shape your thinking in your life? What are you thinking about? Because what you're thinking about is where you're headed in your life. Let me just go a little bit deeper. Our small group is really awesome. It's probably the best one that's out there. Where's Brad at? Is that true, Brad? Is that a true statement?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's really good. So it's a really good one. I got my brothers in that group. We have, I was going to say we have two Adams. We actually have Adon and Adam. Brad, dad's in that group. Wade was there. It's a good time, right? You think it's a good group? It's a great group. Rolinski is in that group. Trey decided he doesn't want to come to our group anymore. So this is kind of just my way of calling him out for not attending. And seemed a little quiet this week without you there. But it's a really good group. But that's a shameless plug for, man, you guys need to get yourself in a small group. They are awesome. They are so healthy. I mean, they are for me, at least. I get free counseling, and Brittany can't tell me how pathetic that I actually am in the middle of it, It's really good. But this is where we went two small groups ago. We were talking about our thoughts and how we have to take captive all of our thoughts. And let me just kind of, I'm not a science person, okay? I actually had to write all of this down, and I'm going to read a lot of it to help make some sense of why we have to take captive our thoughts, all right? So just bear with me, and if I'm wrong, I don't know, maybe I can put crown molding up faster than you can, and we'll, I don't know, who knows. So our brains, I'm going to say most of the people's brains in here, some of them are a little less, are composed of 86 million neurons that are constantly firing. Am I right so far? No one wants to tell me I'm wrong. Okay, cool. So our brains have 86 million neurons. That seems like a lot of something packed into one small space. All right. We think 60,000 to 80,000 thoughts a day. That's a lot. Brittany, I might double the words, but Brittany's thoughts are like double the thoughts. She has way more thoughts than a normal person. 60 to 80,000 thoughts a day. Check this out. 80% of your thoughts are negative thoughts. That's 48,000 to 64,000 thoughts a day that are negative thoughts. 95% of those thoughts are repetitive thoughts too. So you are literally thinking the same thing over and over and over again, and it's negative. That's crazy. So every time that you have the same negative thought, it increases the chance that you're gonna have that same thought again. It's like driving down a dirt road that's wet. You know, anybody drive? I know Justin does. I've been down Justin's road. It's muddy. Yeah. If you drive down a dirt road that's wet, you're gonna build ruts into the road. Y'all know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Yeah, it feels like y'all are going to sleep right now. So you're gonna drive down this road, and the more that you drive over this road, the deeper the ruts are gonna get. It's a grand canyon. To the point where you don't even have to drive anymore. Like, you don't have to hold the steering wheel because your tires can't actually get out of the ruts that have been developed. I mean, like, truly, that's what'll happen. These are called neural pathways in our brains. Am I right so far? Those are neural pathways. We have neurotransmitters that are moving the thoughts, okay, from our neurons or something. Okay, so we have these neural pathways are ruts. I'm going to try to tie this all in together, okay, where even I can understand this. The more that you have these negative thoughts, the deeper that rut gets. And the easier that it is for you to have that same thought again and again and again. So if you have a negative thought towards a person, and you sit there and you think about that person over and over, and you get angrier and angrier and angrier with that person, the deeper that rut's going to get, and the easier that it is for your mind to go right back into the same place. Have y'all ever been there? You can't get somebody out of your mind. How mad you are. It's easy for us to get there. Here's the good news. You can make new roads. You can make new ruts. You can make new neural pathways. You can make new ones. But it's hard because you actually have to think about it. You have to catch your thoughts becoming negative in a chaotic world where it's very easy to just be like, I'm just going to be mad at this person, and I'm not going to forgive this person, and I'm going to be angry. It's very easy to go down that same rut because you've developed it over and over thinking these negative thoughts. But you can create new pathways. Let me just kind of give it to you in a, probably a, I don't know. I did not want to share this illustration, but I felt like God was telling me that I needed to. So I'm going to. I'm just going to embarrass myself. I'm just going to preface it with this. So this week, Brittany and I had a really bad disagreement with each other. And it's bad. Like, I wasn't happy. She was fine. But I was not happy. I'm just being honest. And I'm even more embarrassed to tell you what it was about. So, I made this door for my wife. No, just playing. So I got home from work. My life right now feels chaotic. There's a lot of new stuff and things that I don't know, it's just a new season and kind of some new waves, and it's chaotic. And I'm the kind of person that when my life is chaotic, what I want to do is I want to check things off a box, that way it can feel less chaotic. And so I'd made my mind up Tuesday when I got home from work, I was going to do like three different things. I was going to knock them out, and things were going to be great, and my life wasn't going to be chaotic on Wednesday. And so I got home, Brittany gives me a hug, gives me a kiss on the cheek. She said, dinner's almost ready, can you finish it? I'm headed up to ladies group for Bible study. And I was like, oh yeah, that's gonna make this nice. Thank you. No, you're good. This is gonna make that dramatic. I like it. It's gonna make me sound like an idiot even more. And I got mad. Because I had something I was gonna do. I was like, man, I need to get these things done. And she was like, are you all right? And I was like, I mean, I just had things that I was going to do tonight. And she was like, do you not want me to go to church? Like the preacher telling his wife, like, hey, don't go to the church tonight. And I was like, no, I want you to go to church. I was having a little, like, pity party on myself. And it got to the point where Brittany was like, what's wrong? And I couldn't figure, I don't know if you've ever been that way where you can't actually figure out what's wrong or why you're mad.
Amen.
Yeah, that's where I was. And I was like, all I could say was, I don't know why I'm mad, but I am mad right now. And she was like, how can I help you? You can stop asking me, how can I help you? That's what you can do. Like, I was just in one of those moods. And huh?
That's my job.
I know. Yeah. And so I was like, okay. I said, I'll finish the supper. Just go do your church thing, and I'll be here with the kids. And we didn't talk a whole lot that night when she got back, and it bothered me. You know, I was like, man, this bothers me that I am that person, that I couldn't control my frustration towards my wife for going to church when I'm the preacher like that. It really, really bothered me. And so I went up to Brittany after, after a lot of time in prayer and I told her, I said, hey, I don't need for you to tell me that I was wrong, because I already know that I was wrong. I don't need you to point out what I did wrong, because I already know what I did wrong. I don't need you to give me steps on how I can improve. I don't need that. I said, I just needed to tell you that I was sorry. And I told her this. I said, I began to pray all day about this because it just did not settle well. And my prayer was, God, why are my thoughts, like, why is that the direction that my thoughts went there? Instead of being grateful for the fact that we have a church who's having ladies group on Tuesday and that my wife is there and she's a part of it and, like, she's growing and she's praying for me during those times, probably talking trash about me while she was there. I don't know, that night for sure. And I realized, I began to realize this wasn't a one-time thing. Like, that's not the only time that I've ever done that. I wish I could say that it was, but it's not. And I began to realize this is a natural path that my mind has taken several times. Because I can remember several times where I can think back and go, I don't know why I was frustrated right then, but I was really, really frustrated. And so thinking about this, this is why I went so science, Bill and I on you guys, is that what I realized was that I had developed a neural pathway, a rut that I go to in my life whenever things, I can't control things and things are chaotic. I don't control my thoughts, and that's just where I go. I just get frustrated when I can't control the things in my life. But I don't want to be that way. Like, I don't want to be that way forever. Brittany's like, I definitely don't want you to be that way forever. Like, I don't want to get in trouble for asking what's wrong. So what I began to realize and what I decided to do was I thought, I'm going to retrain my brain. And I'm going to take captive every thought that comes here. And I'm going to recognize whenever I'm frustrated. And I'm going to create a new path in my brain.
Amen.
That's what I'm going to do. And what I've learned is that I've been praying about that, trying to be very, very aware of this, the amount of opportunities that God has given for me to improve on such a topic, where I could easily get frustrated over the past couple of days, but I don't want to be that same person. I don't want to react that way. I bring this up because I don't think anybody wants to be this way either. I think in a chaotic world, every one of y'all in this room probably goes, I don't want to react the way that I react. I want to be more composed, and I want people to see Jesus in the way that I react. Amen? That's what I would say most of us want. How does that happen? You have to set your thoughts on it. This is how it happens. Since you've been raised to life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, not things that are in the air, not angels that are floating on clouds playing harps. That's not the things of heaven. It's thinking about Christ, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. This is how we control our thoughts in a chaotic world. Our words, it's how we can control those, and we control our time by thinking about the things of heaven and not the things of earth. And it takes for us to be aware of these situations before they come up. I just kind of thought about some different things in the Bible. I thought about Joseph. I thought about Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I thought about those guys, and I was thinking, what? Like, they reacted in a really awesome way. Like, how did they react the way that they did? It's because their thoughts were on the things above. And they had already set their mind up before things happened, before they found themselves in a situation. They'd already made their mind up. This is who I'm going to follow. I'm going to pursue God above the things of this world. So set your mind right now. Set your mind on the things of heaven and not the things of chaos. Jesus did this too. The Garden of Gethsemane, before he would go to the cross to be beaten, crucified for our sins, blood would be shed. He would die for our sins. Before he would do that, he would pray this prayer in the garden, and he would say, Father, would you, if there's any way, would you let this cup pass from me? Like, as if to say, like, I don't want to go to the cross. This is going to be awful. But then he follows it up and he says, but not my will, but your will be done. That's setting his mind on his thoughts on the things of heaven. Before it happened, before that Judas would turn him over, before the Romans would put him on the cross, Jesus had already made his mind up that God, if this is what you're calling for me to do, then this is what I'm going to do. So set your mind on the things of heaven. Set your mind on the things of Jesus. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you would help us to set our mind on the things that are above. Help us to set our mind where Christ sits in heaven at the right hand of the Father. Help us not to be chaotic in the things that we do. Help our actions to take away, to lead people to Christ rather than to lead them away. So Father, I pray that you'll help us with that. And I pray with our congregation right here, right now, I pray for just a freedom that comes from the chaos that some people have been living in. It's almost like they like drama maybe. Father, I pray that you would just get them out of that sense and lead them to a place of freedom and take chaos out of their life that they're feeding into. Father, we can't change our world. There's going to be chaos no matter what, but help us to navigate through the waters of chaos in a way that's different. Father, I thank you for Jesus. I thank you that he loved us so much that he died on the cross for my sins. Father, I pray that you would just draw us closer to you right now. Lord, in your name I pray. Amen. Here's what I'm going to ask. I'm going to ask that everybody would go ahead and stand up. We'll have a time of invitation. We're going to sing a song. The altar is open. We have people that are available to pray up here at either side of the altar. We're here to pray for you guys. And just, man, try to recognize places where chaos has been stealing freedom from your life. Let's go ahead and, let's sing. You got a song? Can you sing? Let's sing. Spend some time in prayer if you need to. Since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight, that's the chaos that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. This is how we defeat chaos. Keep our eyes on Jesus. Amen.
Say the blessing. I'm just going to do a few of the announcements for today. So tonight or at 2, the youth, if you did cupcake orders, we got some cupcakes to make. All right. So hopefully some cupcakes to make and some tasting at the same time. So come on at 2 and we'll get those made so we can get those orders filled out for everybody. And I just want to say thank you to Laren. I want to say thank you to Melanie and thank you to Shelby for and all y'all are hustling, and thank y'all for the time that y'all spent on that. Also, we have the actual sign-up forms for the beach camp in the back. All right, so if your kid's going to beach camp, get 2 of those forms. There's one that's in detail what we're doing and where we're going, and then the other one's just the contact information for you and your children. All right, so make sure you grab one of those in the back there by where Cody's at right now. All right, and on Monday nights, we're still having 7:30. We're having men's prayer group in the upper room, so please come on out. If you're not involved in the men's prayer group, and we're coming up there to pray for the lost, we're trying to pray for people maybe who stepped out of relationship with Christ and unity in our town and amongst the churches. And same thing with the ladies. They're doing the similar thing. So come out on Tuesday night at 6:30, huh?
Not this week.
Never mind. All right.
All right. She got. It's because I told her no more church.
All right. On Wednesday we're still hitting up small groups or illumination night. So whatever Wednesday that falls on, y'all come on out. We'd love to see y'all. But if y'all just prepare for the blessing. All right, my wife wants to say something that I didn't know anything about. All right.
Okay, I just wanted to thank all of you guys. The kids have sold over 500 cupcakes.
Woo!
And it's because of y'all's donations that we're able to do that. 500 cupcakes, over 300 strawberries that are going to be dipped. Their little fingers are going to be covered in chocolate. So I just wanted to thank you guys because without y'all, this wouldn't have been possible. So thank you.
Always clap for food. All right, everybody just prepare yourself for the blessing. It says in number 6, it says, may the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. I pray that all for y'all.